Episcopalian Parish Church. During the summer, just to remind you that it is summer, I often find myself drawn to the Old Testament readings which are set for us. Exploring them reminds us that we live and worship within a community of faith which goes back many, many centuries. And so we read ancient stories, but they are stories which open up universal, timeless themes. And they also show us, if we read them with discernment, how the faith of God's people has changed. And that may help us see how it might continue to change. Today our story is of a dream. One of many occasions in the Bible when people gained new perspectives and deeper understandings in sleep. We use the word dream in at least two senses. There are the dreams that we have when we're asleep, which are thought to be related to our brains sorting out and making sense of our waking experiences. And there are the dreams that we have, for example, for the future. Once every dream is involuntary and can be quite strange. The other is an expression of our deepest character and our most cherished hopes. Today we'll see how a dream while asleep set Jacob on a new path in his life, a changed man, now in tune with God. So let us come together and come before God in worship as we sing hymn number 213 in 213, New Every Morning.
Thank you.
creatures cry, your creation groans, but we turn away. We surround ourselves with noises. We are quick to excuse ourselves from responsibility, saying, we're too young. We're too old. We're too tired. We are too busy. We find it hard to imagine that we might make a difference. My life giving up, oh God. Wash us clean. Restore our imaginations and our hearts. Let your courage and compassion flow through our veins until we love our land and our hands reach out in blessing for the creation waits with eager longing for the feeling of the children of God. Lord God, this day we hear you and understand you when you say to us, you are my own. You are forgiven. And I need you to be about my business in the world. Lord God, this day give us hearts and minds and hands and feet quick to respond to your call. Rock of Israel, and cornerstone of our common life, you are not bound by our visions, our structures, our doctrine. We cannot predict your coming or going, yet you have given us your story, made us your family, given us your work to do. Meet us here. Shape us for service in your world, for we carry the name of Jesus and live by the power of your breath. Amen.
The first reading is a reading from the book of Genesis. Jacob left Beersheba and went towards Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night, because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth. And you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring, knowing that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place! This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning, and he took the stone that he had put under his head and set it up for a pillar and poured oil on it on the top of it. He called that place Bethel, but the name of the city was Luz at the first. A second reading, a reading from the Gospel of Matthew. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did those weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this," the slave said to him. "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. Thanks be to God."
Thank you.
and her literary reputation rests mainly on a collection of poetry and just five short books, one of which, The Living Mountain, which has become possibly her best known, lay unpublished for over 13 years. Van Shepherd spent hundreds of days over the course of my life exploring the Cairngorm Mountains, though as she got to know them better and better, she came to see it as one mountain, divided by deep valleys and sculpted by vast colleagues. The Living Mountain describes her experience of the Cairngorms. And in it she writes this: no one knows the mountain completely who has not slept on it. As one slips over into sleep, the mind grows limited, the body melts, perception alone remains. One neither thinks nor desires nor remembers, but dwells in pure intimacy with the tangible world. The moments of quiescent acceptiveness before sleep are among the most rewarding of the day. I am emptied of preoccupation. There is nothing between me and the earth and sky. I have never slept on a mountain, though I did once doze in an old graveyard in Orkney and woke up at 10 of summer. Perhaps because I've never slept on a mountain, I cannot say I know one completely, and that would be true. But it strikes me that what Van Shepherd was describing is as much an experience of getting to know herself as it is of getting to know a mountain. An experience of becoming one with the place where she was resting. The echoes between what Nan Shepherd wrote and what we have read from Genesis this morning are in sure quite obvious. From Genesis we read a story of a man spending a night sleeping outdoors. A story of a man full of preoccupations. A story of a man finding in sleep and waking a new perception of the world and of his life. Jacob was in a sorry predicament. He had tricked his brother out of his brother's rightful inheritance, and Esau was raging. On this journey, Jacob was not only escaping, but he was also being sent by his father to find a wife, to marry one of his cousins, a daughter of his mother's brother. Perhaps Isaac hoped that the marriage would inculcate his son Jacob with a greater sense of responsibility. He had left home, but not yet arrived at the home of his grandfather and his uncle. He is in an in-between place, a liminal place. He is leaving an old life, but has not yet arrived at his new life. Perhaps uniquely in his his life, Jacob is receptive at this point to new possibilities, to new situations, to new and deeper understandings. Literally and metaphorically, he is at a crossroads in his life. As he slept, as his mind grew limited, as his body melted and perception alone remained, neither thinking nor desiring nor remembering, he perceives a connection never before felt by him. Between the things of earth and the things of heaven. He describes it as a ladder between the two, with angels ascending and descending. Perhaps it would be helpful not to think of angels here as beings, but as somehow embodied divine messages. Angels are in the Bible principally messengers. As we've seen recently, in the Old Testament in particular, those who met angels had a sense of having met with God. So it is with Jacob, stretched out on the open ground, a stone his pillow, earth his bed. He perceives a new connection with the land. He perceives the place where he lay as a gift from God, as a home for him and those who would come after him, as a place of blessing. Additionally, he perceives it as a place of encounter, of new relationship, of enduring partnership with God. He wakes, declaring, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." But in truth, the place was only the means by which he realized that God was with him, though he had not known it. And more than a new connection with the land, he perceives a new connection with God. Place is important. For Jacob, it was a place of vulnerability, which opened his mind to perceive the presence of God in his life. Situation altogether. Now shepherd speaks of conception dawn as that God was with him and would keep him wherever he would go and would not leave him. As it was for Jacob, so it is. teach us to pray.
We pray, for all who flee from our pasts, by which they are haunted. We lift up all who feel abandoned by future for which they had hoped but cannot now reach. We plead for all who do not know that they are loved and chosen. Intimation for you this morning. I've had a message from Philip at the storehouse that the things that they're most needing at the moment are